92.1 WROI, and on this wet Monday morning, we're going to go across the console and welcome Dr. Gary Seward of Woodlawn Hospital for Doc Talk. Good morning, sir. How are you?
Hi, yeah, it's Eric.
Eric, why did never mind, I'm losing it.
That's okay. Every time I come in here, I think it's a gray, rainy day. I don't think I've ever been in here when it wasn't.
That's not your fault.
Yeah, I can't possibly be.
That's Indiana. Take a nap, the weather will change.
Yeah. Now, I wanted to talk about menopause today. This is one of the things that we probably, if you were to roll down the list of the five or six things that I see most often, this would rank right in there with one of the more common reasons people come to the office, one of the more problematic things that we have to deal with. And to get into this a little bit, I'm going to start by saying that most women, when they start menarche around age 12, 13, 14, have about 20 to 25,000 functional eggs. Those eggs get recruited in batches of about 15 to 25 at a time. One or two of them grow into a mature follicle, ultimately going through this process every single month until at some point we start to run out of eggs. Now, of interest, the eggs that get recruited are recruited by virtue of how sensitive they are to the signals that come from the hypothalamus and the pituitary gland. They have more receptors for follicle stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone, and so by the time a person gets to, say, 38 or 40 or 42, the eggs that are there tend to be the ones that have fewer or less responsive receptors to these things. So what we usually see is a 5-year, maybe more, maybe less, phase that leads up to ultimate menopause, which is defined by no periods, depending on which definition you use, either 6 months or a year in the face of the right sort of demographics, or you can do it by lab values. You can actually test FSH and LH. One of the more frequent questions I get or comments I get is with regards to hormones. People come in and they want their hormones tested because they think their hormones are low or high, or they might need this or that. And testing hormones really is not a thing. When you test hormones, what you essentially are getting are just sort of a snapshot of these things are produced in pulses and waves, and they're different at night and different during the day, and they're different at one point in the cycle versus another. Whereas FSH and LH are a little bit more consistent. If they are high, that means that they are trying very hard to stimulate an ovary that's not responding well. And if they're high above a certain number, then we can say with some definitiveness that the ovary isn't responding, and ultimately that person's in menopause. Probably the reasons people call in or come into the office to be seen are because they're symptomatic. Only about half of women are very symptomatic. And this is, you know, it's kind of a variable of symptoms. Probably the number one is hot flashes. We get a lot of that. Sleep disorders, mood disorders, which are probably all associated with sleep disorders, which are probably all associated with hot flashes that tend to happen sort of subconsciously at night, are a lot of the main reasons people come in. Occasionally it might be other things like dryness or other irritabilities, hair loss, hair growing in places they don't like, things like that. And
on the 'cause one of the things that people say about this all or talk when they talk about it, things that comes up is the mood disorder. Do I understand you right to say that the hormonal problem can cause the sleep disorder and the hot flashes, okay, and that is what then leads to the mood thing?
I think there's a number of variables, but that's probably the main one.
Okay.
And we've shown, you know, medically speaking, this has been known for some time, and you and I have both experienced this. If you have bad sleep for two or three or four nights in a row, it's hard to be pleasant and chipper.
Yeah, what happens to me, people start wearing garlic around their neck.
It's kind of an interesting phenomenon. A lot of times, and this is something that I think we've all experienced. We all know that person that sleeps 2 hours a night, but they're bouncing off the walls all day, and heaven forbid they have caffeine because they might, you know, explode. And we've all had the experience of sleeping 10 hours and waking up feeling like we could sleep another four. The difference between those two is the folks that have all of the energy after relatively limited sleep are sleeping very powerfully. They're getting good REM, good stage three and four sleep in sort of intense bouts so that they are fully recharging their battery in less amount of time. It's kind of like driving a Tesla and going to a supercharger as opposed to plugging it into your garage outlet. Whereas the rest of us, or when we've had those experiences of sleeping a lot but feeling tired, are probably spending most of our sleep time in stage one and two, sort of a lighter sleep cycle. And so when you're having hot flashes, and these tend to show up more in the night hours, it's a diurnal circadian thing, the sleep patterns change. If you hook people up to sleep monitors, look for REM, look for deep sleep patterns, you find that there's a whole lot less of that. That goes on for not just 3 days, it goes on for weeks and months. And so it's not unusual for people to feel either emotional or irritable or kind of back and forth between I'm okay, I'm not okay. So we do get a lot of the mood problems. On average, menopause sets in about 50, 51. It's a variable. It's like anything in biologic terms. There's sort of a range, a bell-shaped curve range. Typically, one end of that spectrum is around 40. The other end is around 55 or 56, with the majority, the sort of the average Fulton County woman will be stopping her period sometime between 50 and 51, with probably on average about a five-year buildup to that, where you're still having periods. They may be irregular. They may be accompanied by some of these symptoms of sleep or hot flashes or whatever. And then ultimately, they go away. Like I said before, about half of people go through that very gracefully and don't notice a whole lot of a difference, don't ever think to come to the doctor about it or don't want to. The other half is variable from, you know, a year or two of symptoms that sort of come and go and wax and wane and eventually become tolerable, to folks that just never get over it. They fortunately are only a few percent of the population. However, they make up a much larger percent of my daily life because they tend to come see me. Yeah. And those are the ones that tend to have the most trouble. It also depends. It's very genetic. I think it's always a great idea to know your family history. It's certainly good for cancer risks. It's certainly good for heart disease. But it's also good for this. This isn't something that people tend to sit around the Thanksgiving dinner and talk about. So you got to ask. And I would suggest people with older sisters or moms that you know, went through a natural menopause, or maybe even aunts or grandparents, just know about when they went through, and that probably gives you a fairly fuzzy line that's probably going to apply to you. Body fat composition makes a little bit of difference. Certain lifestyle habits. Number one producer of estrogen in our body are ovaries, by leaps and bounds. But the number two is actually converted testosterone in fat tissue. So people that are a little overweight, I guess one positive aspect of that is they tend to produce slightly more estrogen a little longer. That tends to lead to stronger bones, which is a good thing, but it also has some consequences. It tends to raise the risk of endometrial cancer after menopause, among other issues. if people exercise a lot, there's sort of the natural, in fact, this has been studied head-to-head with taking hormone replacement. If a person does intense aerobic exercise, essentially what they're doing is they're taking peripheral control of that little internal thermostat, and hot flashes in particular seem to be less. So that's a great, you know, for somebody that wants to do things without dealing with medicine, one of the more straightforward ways to do that would be through exercise. There's a lot of people that take a lot of funky vitamins. This is generally true, but a few of them have phytoestrogens in them. Soy would be one. It's a little hard to regulate the amount of soy one has to take. It's probably more than one wants to take. I mean, you got to soy yourself up pretty good in order to get sort of a therapeutic amount of phytoestrogen. And if you do that, you're probably running the exact same risk profile, but less measurable than you would by taking medicine. Things like black cohosh and primrose oil and there are several others just haven't panned out, and they don't do better than placebos and tests.
There was one for a while that just seemed like everybody was talking about it, and I think it was called St. John's Wort.
Maybe. Yeah, well, St. John's Wort's more for like memory, I think.
Is that what it was? Okay.
And it's there are a bunch of those, and boy, that would be a huge multi day topic, I think. But we do learn a lot from alternative medicine approaches. I mean, there are certainly some things that work. Niacin's a great example. It works reasonably well for lowering cholesterol. In the case of dealing with menopause, you got to remember this is a multi-billion-dollar industry, and there are a lot of people that would like to avoid coming to see me at all costs. Not me, mind you, but just right. The doctor. And with that in mind, they'll try just about anything. There are a lot of these concoctions, and I have some people that, take a vitamin from the, over-the-counter or from a health food store, and they swear it helps them. And I think that's fine. If it's helping, then it's fine. I wouldn't invest a ton into it until you're pretty sure it's something that works for you. As far as hormone replacement goes, and this is a huge topic and one that I can only kind of touch on today, is probably a topic for another day, but we still do a lot of hormone replacement. In fact, I'm probably the guy to talk to about that. There are risks and there are benefits to just about anything you do in medicine. Just about any kind of medicine that you take has potential side effects. You ever watch TV and see the disclaimers on all the medicines? There are a big long list with just about every one. And that's true for estrogens. Particularly, they thicken blood, so they can create risk for things like DVTs, blood clots, pulmonary embolisms, strokes, theoretically. And that, if you add enough risk factors to that, you end up with the potential for those bad things to happen. On the flip side, they are excellent at what they're meant to do, which is get rid of those hot flashes and help people sleep a little bit better. And we have, it's like so many things in my particular practice, there are people that walk in the door that will, you mentioned the word hormones and they'll hightail it right out of there. They don't want to hear it at all. And on the other hand, I like to tell the story, and I tell this frequently to my patients that are asking. I had an 89-year-old once, and this was back in the days of charts, not e-charts, and I'm looking at the paper, and I see that I've got an 89-year-old patient. I think I know what I'm getting myself into. I walk in the door. There's a lady sitting there on the exam table with a little mini skirt on and a visor and a tennis racket slung over her shoulder. And I'm a friendly guy. I tried to, say hi. Before I could get that out, she pointed that racket at me very menacingly and said, "If you take my hormones away from me, I'm going to hit you with this." And I've thought about her often over the years, partly because I didn't want to get beat up by an 89-year-old, and partly because, boy, if she falls over dead tomorrow from a blood clot, it still was a success. You know, that lady was funky. But, you know, it takes, obviously she had hardy genetics. Obviously she was doing the right thing. You don't get to be an 89-year-old tennis player if you pick up a racket when you're 88. You know, that's a lifetime of good living. In those particular cases, hormones can augment good health, just like they can augment bad health if a 62-year-old has high blood pressure, a touch of diabetes, and, you know, smokes. And so those are all factors that you have to kind of put in. It's a conversation. It's a weighing risk versus benefits and sort of discussing where in the spectrum you are and what you're trying to gain from that. But hormone replacement is still something that we do a lot of. And there are a few medical alternatives that we can discuss that aren't specifically estrogen that may or may not work as well. Sometimes we can deal specifically with the mood issues or the sleep issues separate. And I'm not selling anything when it comes to that. You know, I feel like it's got to be a fair and balanced discussion. And, you know, it's not everybody's sort of built the same. Not everybody wants the same results. And there are different versions of hormone therapy, from pills to patches to creams to more localized treatment. We've got like vaginal creams and estrings and things that work for just local symptoms that are perhaps less risky, but beneficial for certain people. And some people just can't do hormones because of maybe a history of breast cancer or other issues that are tricky. And that's another slippery slope discussion that could take a half an hour unto its own. But it's fuzzy information how breast cancers and hormones are related. It's not super clear. There's probably a slight relative risk increase, but nothing compared to having a sister with breast cancer.
What's the recommended age you start getting a mammogram?
Well, we like, as the ACOG recommends starting at age 40.
40?
But that's tricky because we have a lot of different recommending groups. There's the American Cancer Society, the Radiology Society, the Surgeon Society.
Okay. Well, if I'm getting up to around that age, yeah, say over 40,
yeah,
and, you know, some of the symptoms you're describing could take place long before you're actually in menopause for other reasons.
True.
So I'm starting to experience a couple of things, and I'm trying to figure out if maybe I ought to change my diet, if maybe my, you know, whatever's going on. What is a good age to get a hold of you and say, is this menopause or is this just I ate at a bad restaurant last, or, you know, whatever?
Well, all ages are certainly welcome to come in and talk to me. I think probably the majority of the folks that I talk to are somewhere between late 30s and mid 50s, with probably the sort of the peak incidence of people really complaining about either irregular cycles or other symptoms being probably that 45 to 52 range. You know, we expect if somebody's still having periods after 55 or 56, that needs to be explored, because it's likely not normal. And therefore, we need to try to figure out what's happening. I can't imagine. There's not a day that goes by when somebody in their 40s doesn't come in with irregular cycles, wondering what the heck's going on. And it's almost always either a structural thing like a fibroid or perimenopause. And perimenopause probably wins 2-1 on that battle. Okay. You know, so for the most part, that's when we see people. I'm happy to discuss it at any time. And like I said, just with about every biological thing, it's not one size fits all. Everybody's got their own genetic fingerprint. They've got their own lifestyle habits. Different things affect different people for different reasons. The ovaries sometimes lose eggs if they're exposed to radiation or surgery or other. You know, factors. So lots of things play into that.
If we need to, we can get a hold of you through Woodlawn.
you get a hold of me at Woodlawn. My office is right there at sort of attached to the hospital on the second floor in the, I guess that's the east end of the, the hospital.
I think you're on the webpage under OBGYN.
I should be. I am the department right now. So
I know the feeling.
and we're happy to, you know, I'm happy to discuss these things. I think just as a general information, I think people that are in that age range, you know, it's just sort of good to know what to expect and whether or not things are normal. A lot of people question that. They may not be having a specific problem. They just wonder why are my periods goofy? You know, that's probably why.
And tell everybody your name.
Eric Seward. I'm Dr. Eric Seward.
Dr. Eric Seward.
At Woodlawn Hospital.
And you're the guy who bought Alaska, aren't you?
I was that guy. No, that was Uncle Bill.
Was it Uncle Bill?
That's a whole nother conversation.
Are you literally related to him?
Well, I have to be. How many of us are there?
I guess that's true.
He's an interesting character, and I would love to talk about him sometime. he
pulled off the biggest land deal.
What's kind of interesting about that is he tried to talk the Congress into annexing British Columbia, had a deal set up for it. At the time, British Columbia was a free territory.
Yeah.
And they ultimately wanted to be American, but they chose Canada after the Congress balked at the purchase price. He also tried to buy Hispaniola. He started the process to get the Virgin Islands, which ultimately did happen.
I was going to say,
in Puerto Rico.
Well, what he got Alaska for like 2.5 cents,
It was
just obnoxiously cheap.
And he got ridiculed for it, but I think he was.
I think he came out okay
in the end. Yeah.
All righty, thanks a lot, Doc, for your time. Doc Talk coming your way twice a month here at 92.1 WROI. Have a good day, sir.
Thank you.